one, so unchanging. Ageless one, you're my rock of peace. Lord of all, I depend on you. I call out to you again and again. I call out to you again and again. You are my rock in times of trouble. You lift me up when I fall down, all through the storm. Your love is the anchor. My hope is in you alone. Faithful one, so unchanging. Ageless one, you're my rock of peace. Lord of all, I depend on you. I call out to you again and again. I call out to you again and again. You are my rock in times of trouble.
My shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is good.
Good morning, church. My name is Tony. I'm one of the leadership team here, and you're very welcome in joining us this morning. and we hope that you'll have a good time worshipping God together with us today. The program is quite varied as usual. We've got testimony, we've got talk from Joe Wharton on the second part of his series in Nehemiah, and then later on we're going to share communion together. So you might like to get some bread and wine ready in order to be able to participate in that. First of all, I'm going to see a little video which will introduce things to us and which will encourage us in focusing on Jesus.
So many things vying for me, swarming, gathering, swirling, spiraling, fighting for my time, calling for my eyes, crowding my vision, demanding my energy, hungry for my life, shouting loud, storming my mind.
A still, small voice beneath the noise undercuts the storm, whispering, urging, inviting. Come, worship, see.
Come, worship, see.
Worshipping you changes perspective. Lift our eyes to you. Our eyes made new, everything filtered through the lens of your goodness.
Scattered, we carry your presence with us, guiding our steps, changing atmospheres, navigating, discerning worldly strife, filling and sharing your holy life, understanding priorities right. In your light, do we see light?
In your light, we see light, it said in the video. And as we come before God to worship him this morning, we want to see things in a right perspective. For worship brings us into a right perspective of things. Somebody sent me this week a song which was a new version of an old song that we used to sing years ago, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. And that doesn't mean that the things of the world are just going to disappear, but it does mean that we begin to see things in a right perspective. In God's light, we see light. And now Martin is going to lead us in a time of sung worship, after which Sarah Thurley will be telling us something of her experience of God's hand upon her life.
Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. I sing all that you've done for me. Ooh. stunning. All of his brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done.
Blessed be the name of Good morning. This time last year, I faced a new challenge. I had absolutely no idea what I wanted to do next. In 1993, I came back from Nepal, where I'd been teaching and working with a mission organisation. I was unwell and I had a long road to recovery. However, after the first few years, I started formulating a plan about how I would be able to potentially go and work abroad again. And this entailed changing my career and studying and working hard and studying again. And eventually in 2016, I went back abroad, this time to Afghanistan, and had a wonderful job and had a really amazing time and felt like I'd arrived. I could have stayed there, but I decided to come back and finish my master's. At the end of 2019, I had completed that as well. And so at the beginning of 2020, I felt like everything was complete, and I really didn't know what would come next. So I asked God to show me the way. And in the meantime, I studied more online courses and I thought about which country I might like to be in. I thought about maybe learning a new language, and I just kept on pushing doors, but nothing felt right. And God said to me, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you." And so I said, "Yes, God, thy will be done." And I continued to search and to push doors and continued to get absolutely nowhere. And God said to me again, "Seek first my kingdom." And he added this time, "Stop trying to do this in your own strength. What I have for you next is not going to rely on your experience. It's not going to rely on your learning. It's not going to be done by your willpower. I am going to be doing something new. And it's going to be done by surrender." And so this time I listened and I stopped. I asked God to refine me, to strip away all distractions. And that started with stopping looking at the job pages every day. But it went much deeper than that, going back into all sorts of things from the past, things that were hidden that I wasn't really aware of, and just stripping it all away so that I could be totally focused on him. As I followed this path of surrender, doors began to open. They weren't doors, however, that the ones that I'd been pushing. God had a new direction, a different direction for me, one that I wasn't even aware half of the time. I wasn't sure if I wanted to do it. And so as I asked God, "Is this right?" He said, "Yes, this is the way, walk in it." And as I walked, everything fell into place. And so now I'm on the verge of going away again to work abroad. I'm not going to be doing a job that I've fought for and won, but one that I've been given. And I'm not going to be earning as an independent woman, but I am going to be a volunteer, dependent on others. I feel humbled and I have a strong sense of my need of God. This was achieved not by might, not by power, but by his spirit. Surrendering for me is a process, not a one-off, and I continually need to stop and align myself with God, putting him first and fixing my eyes on Jesus. It's only when he is everything that I can serve him as he should be served, and that I can become who I'm meant to be in him, and that I can learn to show compassion and love as he does. And so I would like to thank all of you for the love and care that you have shown for me over the past couple of years as I've been living back with Mum. And I also thank you for your ongoing commitment to me as I go away. And I hope that when I next hear that I will be able to see you face to face. And until then, I ask that God will bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. We pray that God will bless and prosper you in your new ministry, and we shall look forward to hearing of your safe arrival and having your news updates from time to time. We're now going to have a time of prayer, and it might be good if you join in with me and read the words that are coming up on the screen. Sometimes it's good to just feel that we're part of reading these things and praying these things together as a group of God's people. And that's a real encouragement that I find from time to time when we enter into that sort of prayer, liturgical type prayer. We don't always do it, but I thought we would do that today. So let's enter into our prayer time, and you can join me in these prayers. Thank you, God, that you invite us to bring our prayers to you. We acknowledge your holiness. We celebrate your goodness. We delight in your love. Forgive us when we fail you and go our own way. We are sorry for the things that have displeased you. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us. Thank you, God, that you invite us to bring our prayers to you. We ask, Lord, that in these difficult times, we might keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. There seem to be so many distractions, but keep us steadfast in our faith. Thank you for all your promises that assure us of your love. On the mountaintop and in the valley, we will worship you. Thank you, God, that you invite us to bring our prayers to you. We pray for our national and community leaders, that you will guide them in the difficult decisions they have to make. We pray for a real sense of unity across the political spectrum, enabling people to work together in harmony as we seek to live with the present restrictions. Thank you, God, that you invite us to bring our prayers to you. We thank you for the rollout of the COVID vaccinations and pray that this will make a real impact upon the spread of the disease. We pray for all those working so hard in our hospitals to care for those who are ill from whatever cause. Thank you, God, that you invite us to bring our prayers to you. We pray for children, young people, and teachers as the education system has been disrupted again this term. Protect them, inspire them, comfort them. Thank you for the work that continues both on a Sunday and midweek amongst the young people at GBC. Help their leaders to enable them to grow in faith and to be encouraged and helped through the online contact that is available. Thank you, God, that you invite us to bring our prayers to you. We pray for those in our church family who are, for whatever reason, struggling at the moment. There are many and varied needs, and you know each one. We can now name before God those known to us in our fellowship, in our family, and elsewhere, who might need God's special touch at this time. So we'll have a moment of quiet while you can do that. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thank you, God, that you invite us to bring our prayers to you. Thank you that you hear us. Thank you for your words of encouragement. I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. Amen. Martin's now going to lead us in some more sung worship, after which Joe will come and continue our series on Nehemiah. So thank you, Martin.
Brought me in, oh, his love for me.
is free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. The sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. So pretty.
Hello there. Well, today I want us to think about a concept that's not hugely popular in our culture today. It's a concept, a word that we probably don't really see often on social media. We don't hear about it on the radio. And as we hear it, perhaps it sounds a little bit old-fashioned, a bit strange and archaic, a bit dull even. But the reality is, the word that we are going to be thinking about today is in fact the key to life. The word that we are thinking about is repentance. Now, repentance might be a word that means a lot to you, or it might mean absolutely nothing to you. Perhaps you've hardly ever heard it before, except perhaps in some kind of religious parody. But let me just share a few instances of what repentance has looked like in my life. There was a time a number of years ago where I was watching a documentary, and part of that documentary, they showed a young boy, a boy of around 10 years old, and this boy couldn't go to school. His family couldn't afford to even let him go to school because he had to work all day picking tea leaves on the family farm. And I remember seeing that, and seeing that young man's life moved me and it changed me. It moved me from living in a story where the most important thing that mattered was me getting cheap tea to moving me to a story where actually I'm not at the center of the universe. Other people are made in the image of God and I need to make financial decisions that aren't just about me getting a good deal but are about what is good for other people. And so now, in our household, we only buy fair trade tea and coffee. I was moved in that way. Or I think about another time when I was out in South Africa and a colleague of mine brought me up on a really bad habit that she noticed that I had. She confronted me and just said, "Joe, did you realize every time I speak, you often end up talking over me?" And it hurt me to hear that, but she was right. And as I listened to what she said, it changed me, and it moved me from living in a story where the only thing that matters is what I have to say, to living in a story where actually other people have things that they have to say, and I might actually learn something if I listen instead of just speaking all the time. Often, when we think about repentance, we think of it as, oh, I've broken the rules, and therefore I need to say sorry. And well, there's certainly some truth in that. That is one aspect of what repentance can mean. But what if we primarily saw repentance not so much as an act of saying sorry, but as an act of turning from one story and turning to live in another? What if repentance is actually about getting our lives in line with God's story? This is our second talk in our series on the book, a book of the Bible called Nehemiah. And last week we thought about the big story of Nehemiah. We saw that it's a book that talks about the rebuilding of the walls of Jerusalem, but yet it's about so much more than just stones. We thought about the big plans God had for Nehemiah and for his fellow Israelites. And we thought about the big plans that God has for us as his people today. That big plan for us to live with him, to become more like him, and to serve him and to represent him in this world. Well, today I want us to look at a couple of bits of Nehemiah, to see what they have to say about this theme, about this concept, this word of repentance. I would like us to think about the relationship that exists between repentance and the story that we live by. So let's start to have a look. Well, as we saw last week in chapter 1, Nehemiah finds out about the terrible state that Jerusalem is in, and he weeps, and he fasts, and he prays. And we pick up kind of where we left off last time. This is part of Nehemiah's prayer, his prayer of confession. And just listen how he confesses and how he repents in light of the big story of God. We pick up his prayer in chapter 1, partway through verse 6. This is what he prayed. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly towards you. We have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if your exiled people are at the farthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. They are your servants and your people, whom you redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. If you have a Bible, I encourage you to leave it open at that point. You're going to need it again in just a moment. But just look at what Nehemiah is saying here. He's recognizing that he and his countrymen, both in the present and in the past, have failed to live in line with God's big story. They had not been living the way God intended for them to live. And Nehemiah says, God, I want to do something about this. So that's our first instance of repentance. There's another one that we're going to look at in a few weeks' time. So we're going to skip over that, and we're going to skip right now to chapter 9 of the book of Nehemiah. And by the time we get to chapter 9, a lot has happened. The walls have been rebuilt. The people have gathered. They've listened to God's word. All of this has been in spite of a lot of opposition. But amazingly, the wall is built and we are now in chapter 9. And what happens in chapter 9 is the people assemble. It says they assemble as one and they confess their sin publicly. They repent as a community. It's something that they didn't just do by themselves, but that they did together. And chapter 9 is quite a long chapter, one of the longest chapters in the book of Nehemiah. So we're not going to read the whole chapter now, but what I want to do is just flag up a few things from that chapter that will either help you to go away and read it later, or what you could even do, because this is one of the great things about online church, is you can pause me, or you can even fast forward me if you want to. I mean, please don't do that, or if you do that, please don't tell me. But you could even pause me right now and read Nehemiah chapter 9 and then press play once you've done that. So, chapter 9, the people get together and they have this big kind of public declaration. And what they're essentially doing in that declaration is they are recapping the story of Israel, the story of God's work in the world up until that point. And it starts with God as creator, and it recaps all the ways that God has been generous and faithful and kind and forgiving ever since he made humankind. And so in chapter 9, the people, they recall the way that God had called their forefather, Abraham, many, many years before. They remember the way that God had redeemed and rescued the Israelites from slavery in Egypt. They remembered how God had given his people a law to follow, a good law that was good for them and good for the people around them. They recalled how God had forgiven them so many times, even after they had turned away from him and had followed other gods. They remembered and they recalled the way that God had always provided for his people, and the way that despite their constant rebellion, God was always faithful to them and always full of mercy. And then in Nehemiah chapter 10, the people promise that they are going to get back in line with this story that they have been recounting, that they will live faithfully. They promise to be the people who God has called them to be and to begin to do the things that God was calling them to do. Because you see, that's what real repentance is about. Repentance is not just about us trying to get rid of our feelings of guilt and shame. Although when we repent, that is an amazing thing that God graciously does enable. Repentance is not just recognizing that we have broken a rule or a set of rules. Although, as I say, that is an element of it very often. But at its heart, repentance is about recognizing that we have failed to live in the right way within the story of God. The story where he is in charge, where his ways are best, where we have this incredible calling, as I say, to live with God and to become like him and to serve him and to represent him in the world. So I wonder about you. I wonder about your life in this time. What story or what stories are you living by? And how are they shaping the way that you think and feel and live? Perhaps for you, you find yourself these days living under the story of consumerism. The story of consumerism basically says that the world is about acquiring stuff. And the more stuff that you can acquire and the better stuff you can acquire, then the happier you will be and the more significant you are and the more fulfilled you are as a person. Are you believing that story? Is that the story that you are living under? Are you constantly dissatisfied with what you have and forever trying to spend your way to contentment? I promise you, living that way is a recipe for misery, and it is a shallow way to live that will not fulfill or satisfy you. God's story is better than the story of consumerism. Or here's another story that many of us might be living by. Perhaps it's the story that says, in order to be significant, you must always be achieving. That you must always be super productive. If that is a story that you live by and it's a popular story today, you will find it very, very hard to rest. You will find it hard to ever feel satisfied. God's story is better than the story of achievement and self-fulfillment. Or perhaps you're living by the story of comfort. That's the story that says life is about avoiding pain at whatever cost. Well, when we live according to the storyline of comfort, it means that we always make the easy decision. It means we find it hard to delay gratification. And the concept of sacrifice is just completely missing when we live according to the story of comfort. But God's story is much better than living the shallow story of living for comfort. You see, the thing is, our culture generates more storylines than the team who write EastEnders. All of these other stories that we might choose to live by are dead ends. They may look appealing. Sometimes we might even be jealous of other people who are living by those storylines and are apparently succeeding. But the reality is, in the end, they don't fulfill. They don't satisfy. They don't lead to blessing for us. They don't lead to blessing for others and for this world. God's story is the best story. This period that we are living in right now, this period of this coronavirus, it's a time where life is massively disrupted. Our individual lives are disrupted, our family life, our communal life, our national life, even the life of our world has been massively turned on its head. And the reality is, it's very, very unpleasant. And maybe unpleasant is not a strong enough word for how you are experiencing things right now. But perhaps this time, as unpleasant as it might be, perhaps in God's goodness, it might serve an important function in our lives. Perhaps this time of disruption might act as a kind of reality check. Perhaps in the midst of the struggle, the frustration, and the grief, it will be an opportunity for us to take a long, hard look at our lives and at the stories that we are living by. Maybe in this time, God has revealed or is revealing or will reveal to us just the weakness and the wrongness of some of those other stories that we might be living by. And perhaps in this time, he's inviting us once again to live our lives in line with his good story. And it's only as we do this, as we learn to line up our lives with God's story, that we can rebuild this world and our lives in the way that God intends. Otherwise, we're just going to go back to just doing exactly what we did before. Now, there'll be some of you who are watching today, and you will already be living your life in line with God's good story. And maybe at the moment you're finding it really difficult to do that. Perhaps there are challenges, struggles, temptations, just things pulling you away from that story, making it harder for you to live that way. But I promise you, living according to God's story is the best way to live. So if that's you, stick with it. Stick with God. Stick with his ways. It isn't easy, but you are on the path to life. Or maybe there are others of you listening in today, and if you're honest with yourself, perhaps over the last few weeks, last few months, maybe even for a number of years, you know that you once lived under God's story, but these days you find yourselves living under one of those other stories, perhaps the story of consumerism or of achievement or of comfort or of some other storyline. Perhaps today, you hear the voice of the Spirit calling you back, calling you away from the dead end, unsatisfying storyline that you are currently living under. And you hear the Spirit calling you to step back into God's story and to live with him once again fully in the way that he intends for you. Or maybe as you watch this today, you have never ever made that decision to live your life in line with God's story. Maybe before today, you hadn't even heard that there was a story of God that you are invited to live in. Perhaps you've always thought of Christianity as being just a set of rules or of beliefs you have to sign up to, or some kind of principles that you live by. Perhaps you've never really heard or understood that the Bible doesn't just lay out principles or rules, but it tells us a big story. Well, God's story is longer than time itself. And so to do it justice in just a few sentences isn't easy, and I'm not claiming that I'm about to do that. But what I want to do is just let you know some of the key turning points in that story for you to consider and to think about. In the beginning, God made the world, and he made it with good intentions. This universe, your life, it's not all here just by random chance. Everything, including you, has been made by a God who loves you and who wants a relationship with you and who has good plans for you and for this world. But what happened is, us humans, we decided from very, very early on, and we continue to make this decision today, that we don't want to live in God's story, that we want to go our own way. We want to be free from God. We want to just live our own way. And so we ended up rebelling against God. And if you want to know the consequences of what rebellion against God looks like, then take a look around you at the world right now. Look at what we have ended up doing with it and to it. But the incredible thing is, God didn't see us rebel against him, and he doesn't just watch us ruining this beautiful world and ruining the people around us and say, do you know what, enough of these people. I'm just going to wipe the whole world out. I'm just going to go off in a huff. I'm just going to start again somewhere else. He doesn't do that. He hasn't done that. God had a plan, and he has a plan. He has ultimately stepped into this creation through the person of Jesus to make everything new, to restore everything, to forgive us, to give us hope, and to bring us back to himself, and to help us to get in line with his good story once again. God wants to forgive and to heal. And in order to do that, it meant Jesus came to this earth, and it meant him dying an ugly, brutal death on a Roman cross and being raised again so that we could experience that forgiveness and that healing and that hope that God longs to give to us. And then even today, God is calling out. He's calling out to all humanity, and he is calling out to you. He's reaching out to you. He is inviting you to accept him, to live with him, and to stop living according to whatever other story you might be living by, and to live with him in his good story. God loves you, and because he loves you, he wants to know you. He wants you to follow his son. He wants to forgive you. He wants you to discover life in all its fullness. That is his heart for you. And the amazing thing is, life with God, living in his story, is something that can start right now. It's something you can have right now. And so if that is something that you are thinking about, or if that is a decision that you want to make, then there's just a couple of things I want to encourage you to do. One is, I encourage you to talk to God. Okay, he is real. He is listening to you. He is there with you right now. And he wants to embrace you, and he wants you to get to know him. So just start talking to God now. If you want to live your life with God, just say to God, I'm sorry that I've lived by other stories. I want to live according to your story. Thank you so much that you have made that possible through Jesus. Begin that conversation with God today. I'm not saying that's how that's the end of the conversation, but that's a great way to start a conversation with God. And then the second thing I invite you to do is, if that is something that you have done, or if that is something that you are thinking about, then talk to a Christian you know. Perhaps someone in your family, perhaps a friend, perhaps someone from this church, perhaps someone from another church. If you don't know any individual Christians that you can talk to, then I encourage you, Google Godmanchester Baptist Church. Get in touch with us, and we would love to talk to you more about what it means to live your life with God, following Jesus, living in his story, and being a rebuilder for him and his kingdom. You see, God is so faithful. And for all of us, whether we've been Christians for a long time or a short time, or if we're really struggling in our faith, or if we're not even at a point where we have any faith in God at all, the reality is that God is faithful, and he will restore us. When we get back in line with his story, he does restore us. He forgives us, and he gives us grace. He did it back then, and he's still doing it today. And so this week, wherever we might be, whatever we might be up to, by the grace of God, let's seek to live our lives according to a story that is the most beautiful and true of all stories, the story of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just thank you so much for your faithfulness. And Lord, I thank you that despite the fact that we often turn away from you and seek to live according to other stories, that you continue to invite us back to live with you and to live under your good story. Lord, we thank you for the incredible price that you have paid to make that possible. And Lord, we pray that in all we do this week, we might find the joy of living with you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you very much, Joe, for that. We're now going to celebrate communion together. It might seem strange me using that word together, because we're not together. You may be with someone as you take part in communion within your house, within your household, but we're not together as church, which is how communion is to be celebrated. But one of the things about communion is the fact that we're using the bread and the wine, or substitute, to remember this amazing thing, the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But as we use the bread and the wine, and in that way, we share with so many people who have taken part in communion throughout the centuries. This isn't something that's just happening now. It's something that Christians have done together for so, so long. So we do it together. We may be sitting on our own as we do it, but we're doing it with others. And it doesn't matter when you are watching this recording. Doesn't matter when you have sat down, maybe you need to pause for a moment and find bread and wine or substitutes. Maybe you're watching this during the week, or maybe many weeks after it's been recorded, you've come across this and you're sharing in communion at this time. You are still doing it together with hundreds, thousands, billions of Christians around the world throughout time. This meal that we share is a command that Jesus gave. All those years ago, the night that Jesus betrayed, the day before he was killed on that cross, Jesus sat there with his friends, with his disciples. They were sharing that amazing Passover feast. And Jesus, during that, he said something different. Before we get to that, let's pray together. And as we pray, as I pray, why not think about someone else? Maybe someone who you know would take communion, someone maybe that you would sit alongside here in the building if we were doing communion here. Maybe another Christian that you know, maybe someone, a friend of yours, a friend who lives on the other side of the world maybe. But think of someone else who would share in this moment with you and pray that they would know the power of God, the power that is represented in the body and the blood now. Let's pray. I encourage you to pray as well. God, at this time, we are on our own in so much of what we do. But God, because of your spirit, because of you, we are joined with others. God, as we pray now, as we stop to think about others that we know, God, I pray that you would help us to feel connected with other Christians. Other Christians we know well who might live around the corner, Christians we've known in the past, Christians that we know around the world. But God, that we would feel connected now to them. Paul, who wrote a lot of the New Testament, and in one of his letters he writes to the church in Corinth, he says this: "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.' For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Hopefully you've got yourself bread and wine or substitutes at home. And I encourage you now, as you take the bread, if it's not already been cut up, to just rip yourself a piece of the bread off. And just before you eat it, we're doing this not because we're hungry and thirsty, not because it's mealtime. We're doing this in remembrance. Doing this to bring back to mind Jesus' death and resurrection. His body, which was broken on that cross for us, for you, for me. He did it for us. Don't rush. In the moment, just remember to give thanks. Let your heart be full of thanksgiving as you stop to remember what Jesus did. His body on that cross for us. And on that cross, the blood that was shed, the Lamb of God, the sacrifice that was made for us, the blood that was shed so that our sins can and will be forgiven. As you stop, just before you take that drink, as you drink the wine, again, let that thankfulness rise up within you. Let your heart become full of thankfulness for what Jesus did. For us, for you and for me. Blood was shed that we may be friends with God. Encourage you to speak out. Maybe there's people around and you can't do that. Maybe it's not possible, but if it's all possible, just to speak out those words. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God, thank you. Thank you for today. Thank you for now. Thank you for communion. Thank you for that moment to stop and remember again. That stop to be reminded, that moment to be reminded of what happened and the importance and the significance of it. God, I thank you that by doing this, it helps us not to take it for granted. It brings back to mind the importance of what you did and how grateful we are for it. God, I pray that as we eat, as we drink, as we worship you in this way, a form of worship, that God, we would know that joy of our salvation, that because of this, that we know salvation. God, thank you that we know your salvation. Thank you for saving us. Amen. Amen. Maybe that was the first time you're taking communion. Maybe you don't take communion because you're not really sure what it's about. Can I encourage you to contact us? We often talk about contacting us at the office, phoning or emailing, and that isn't the same as being able to talk to someone if we were here together and be able to meet up. But we can still connect. We can still talk. We can still arrange a digital meeting or talk on the phone or just continue to grow together. And maybe for you, communion is something which you're not sure about and you'd like to know more. Maybe you've heard us talk about the death and resurrection of Jesus. And what does that mean? What does it mean for my sins to be forgiven? Find someone. Maybe you know a Christian. Ask them. But find out more and know what it is to have that joy. Maybe you are a Christian and that joy is a little bit hidden right now. Then I encourage you, when this broadcast finishes, spend some time remembering the joy of your salvation, the joy that comes from God. That's the end of our broadcast this morning. Thank you to all those that have taken part. It's great to be able to continue doing church in this different way and being able to be church with one another. So thank you for that. A few things just to mention again, just to remind people of, this evening we have our prayer meeting at 7:30 on Zoom. If you'd like details of that, please email us. We'll get those details to you. And just an opportunity at this time for us to commit ourselves to prayer. I encourage you, if you're free at 7:30, why not join us? Come along and to join that prayer meeting and to join with others. Something good about joining together with others as we pray. But before that, this afternoon, our next Songs of Praise broadcast is live at 4 o'clock on YouTube. So look out for that. It would be great for you to watch that. If you're part of our normal Songs of Praise congregation, or if you're just interested in what happens, then that will be there at 4 o'clock. So please be aware of that. On Monday evening, so tomorrow evening, we have our members meeting online. If you're a church member, can I encourage you to join us in the broadcast for that important church members meeting. Please join us for that. Again, in a virtual way, but it's an important thing for us to do, to join together when we can. And again, if you're not a church member and you're thinking, I'd love to be a church member, I'd love to know more about that, then again, please make contact with us. Let us know and we're able to connect back and to talk to you about these things, which are really exciting. And the other thing just that I would want to let you know is next Sunday evening, we're going to have a memorial service, a virtual memorial service for many friends that have passed away in this last year. And we haven't had the opportunity to celebrate their lives, to give thanks to God for them. And in a different way, it'd be an opportunity for us to say goodbye. So if you would like details about that, that's next Sunday evening at 7:30. It'll be on Zoom, opportunity for us to be together again in a virtual way, but in a way which allows us to say goodbye to those people. Thank you very much for joining us. I pray that you know God with you. Stay safe and we'll see you soon.